Are you ready to rewind? Take a nostalgia-filled ride back to a simpler time. It's Acid Wash Memories, a retro pop culture celebration. And now your hosts, Joe Marotta and Michael Quinn.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to episode number 54 of Acid Wash Memories, a retro pop culture celebration. Today, we're talking about why Nancy Kerrigan and Tonya Harding. My name is Joe Marotta, and joining me on the ice is Michael Quinn. How you doing there, Michael?
Why?
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 Maybe you guys are asking why we're talking about this.
It's
but
a very notable thing.
It is. It's very notable.
That question was all over the news of the day.
It was, and we want to answer that question today. Thank you so much for being with us here. If you're wondering why we do this show, well, we are a retro pop culture celebration. Each week is a different slice of retro pop culture, usually from the 80s or 90s, but sometimes we go way back, talk about the history of things like that. And if you're not interested in figure skating, and who isn't, there are 53 other episodes available where, Michael Quinn?
In the archives.
In the archives. So you can find something you like there. And whether you're a first-timer or a long-timer, we would love it if you follow us over on Twitter at AWM Podcast and join our friendly Facebook group where, Quinn, people talk about old stuff and we call it Home Crap Home.
Yes, Home Crap Home. It's the king of old things.
I like that.
It's not really a king. It's not like a person.
Or no king queen
but
no more.
It's the king site of this.
The king site. Yeah,
the king site. The king of sites.
So go to facebook.com/king site.
Emperor of the internet.
And you can join our group. Acid Wash Memories will let you in. That's it for the very serious particulars, right, Michael Quinn? All right, so we're talking about Nancy Kerrigan. We're talking about Tonya Harding.
Who are they?
Well, on January 6, 1994, many of you probably remember this, 30 years now.
I was watching it.
I was watching it as well. What began as a routine figure skating practice became a national news sensation. America Quinn was inundated with this bizarre, unprecedented story. Like, this type of stuff is normally reserved for TV movies.
Someone was running by me and he just, like, whacked me with this long black, like, stick.
You know what I found very interesting about it? I know, obviously, it wasn't a setup as far as, like, the news is concerned. Like,
right.
But I swear there was, like, media hype around this matchup prior to the, like, incident.
Yes, there
right?
was.
Like, I don't know why I knew about this, and I don't know why my mother really wanted to watch this shit, but it was, like, suddenly we were an ice skating family, like, prior to like the why. Like,
that's great.
So, like a couple of weeks before, everyone's like, this is gonna be like this big national moment and all this shit.
Yes.
And like everyone's talking about, like, it is kind of weird that what went down just because of it was like set up. It was like pre like readied by the media.
It was preordained, these two rivals here, you know.
Right.
And to have a situation where two top-notch skaters, and they both were,
right,
one of them is attacked, and the story unfolds that her chief rival could have been behind it. I mean, it really did take, this is simpler times in 94, it really did take America by storm.
Well, I mean, even now it would take America by, because
I think so.
It's not like, you know, the Super Bowl's coming up and like somebody hits Tom Brady in the back of the leg with a baseball bat and like to like that, and it was planned by like the opposing team.
That would,
like,
be funny, actually.
Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, this is like not normal. Period in sports.
No, it's
like,
not
at all.
It's
like,
not even normal in polite society.
Right.
This is not supposed to happen, right?
Right.
It's just not nice to
this
do.
This is like mafia stuff. Like,
it
this is like,
man,
we're going to take your legs out because you didn't pay us or something.
And not like, even like good mafia stuff, like low level
mafia. Like, they send the like goobers to do it. It's not even like the important like
right.
assassin man, like,
no,
that's like highly paid.
This is some crap.
Yeah.
So before we talk about why, we're also going to talk about who, what, where, when, and how. But the main question, Quinn, is, what is ice?
When water hits freezing level, it becomes ice. Us humans have devised different things to do with ice. You know, we cool our groceries and like all sorts of stuff. But some people figured out that if you get like a blade and you go on, like you walk on it with the blades on your feet, that you can skate.
There
and so,
you go.
And thus a sport was born.
Figure skating. We'll give you a brief rundown of this, because, again, that's what we do on the show. So believe it or not, figure skating goes all the way back to about 3000 BC.
Oh, really?
It does, because they had ice back then.
Oh, shut up.
The early skates were obviously primitive because this is primitive times. They were made out of like animal bones and skins and stuff.
Well, I mean,
like that.
It's not like people knew how to like readily make iron and stuff like that.
They didn't have Gore-Tex back then, as far as I know. But the skates continued to be improved mainly by the Dutch in the 1200s and 1300s. And the first ice skating association was formed in Edinburgh, Scotland. In the 1700s, London then formed one in 1830, Fish and Chips, of course.
Fish, chip.
Oi, mate, just skating on the ice after having a nice chip butty and going to watch the footy later, yeah? Fish and Chips.
In New York City, Central Park opened their first ice skating pond.
No, they didn't call it a rink.
I guess they didn't. In 1858, and that sparked renewed interest in this sport of ice skating in the United States. And the first known ice skating competitions were held in the late 1800s, and it debuted as an Olympic sport at the 1908 Summer Olympics in London.
Weird.
Summer, yes. Yeah, so
they have to like make an igloo and all this shit.
Well, London,
how
did
they even refrigerate at that time? It was like harder.
They just had a bunch of guys with fans blowing on it. Okay.
Yeah. Now, I mean, refrigeration, I think, existed by 1908.
It did. I believe so.
Very expensive.
Very expensive, Douglas. The modern Olympics had started with the 1896 Summer Games in Athens, Greece. And the winter sports, and this is why I wanted to mention this, winter sports continued to be featured in the Summer Games up to 1920. It was in 1924 when the IOC, that's the International Olympic Committee, they decided that besides the upcoming 1924 Summer Games in France,
right,
they were going to have separate winter games, and these were held in Chamonix, France. I'm butchering that, sorry.
Horrible. You should not speak about my country.
Hey, wait, who the hell are you?
My name is Henri.
Well, nobody makes fun of the boys except me, you hear? Go have a croissant and shut the fuck
in February and January.
This kind of makes sense because if you only had the summer, one of the big problems is like, for example, skiing. Like you can't do that in the summer, no matter what. Like you can get,
you have to do all of these in like Norway.
Like, yeah, you can get like an ice skate rink. You can do that
indoor
in the summer.
Rink, yeah.
Yeah, but you cannot do like the other, you know, skiing specifically back then. And then eventually snowboarding and all the other
luge,
the stuff with the snow, basically. You can't do any of the snow shit.
You can't do any snow shit.
Hey. Who the hell was that French motherfucker?
So that's how we came upon winter games and summer games. Now, they continue to be held every 4 years, the same year. And this went on all the way through into the 80s. And it was in the mid-80s that that same IOC, the International Olympic Committee, they decided, you know what? Sometime soon, we're going to split these games between summer and winter in different years.
This makes sense to me because it is kind of, it feels like a missed opportunity. It's like you got to wait 4 years for both of them when there's like, there's two separate things. You might as well just put them like in between each other.
Yeah, exactly.
Like it just doesn't make any sense.
And we, and some of you obviously remember this from growing up when all the Olympics were every 4 years. I do as well, because the final winter games to be held the same year as the summer was February of 92.
Right.
So there were 92 Olympic games out in France.
The Olympic Winter Games are coming to CBS. Share a moment with the world.
So I guess, what, did they choose that the winter would be the one to get the quick cutoff?
The hop over.
So that it could meet its like time that it is now?
Exactly. So what they did is they planned on another Winter Games only 2 years later. That way they're finally staggering them.
The Olympic Winter Games return to CBS.
So that was going to be the 1994
Olympic Games. But, you know,
Olympic
for the athletes, though, this is a very rare opportunity to get, like, a quick second chance, no?
Yeah, only 2 years instead of
right?
four.
Like,
sure.
It's, like, the only time it's ever going to happen. So it's, like, maybe you came in second in the other one. It's, like, wow, you get, like, a second shot at this real quick, and you're not going to age out or anything because it's, like, a young person's game.
And in the 92 Winter Olympics, there were three young ladies who represented the United States in the ladies' figure skating competition. Christy Yamaguchi, who won the gold medal in 92.
I remember her. She was a big deal.
We all do.
Yeah.
The 20-year-old daughter of a Northern California dentist, Christy Yamaguchi. She's in first place, and she now skates for the gold.
Tanya Harding, who placed fourth.
Right.
When we return, the second American to skate, Tanya Harding from Portland, Oregon.
And a lady by the name of Nancy Kerrigan, who won the bronze for the U.S. in 92.
Nancy Kerrigan, the elegant young skater from the Northeast, also has an intriguing personal story.
Let's talk about Nancy Kerrigan. Let's start with her, okay? So she was born in October 69 in a suburb of Boston. She had begun skating at age 6, and she won the Boston Open for children at age 9.
Wow.
Okay, that's the late
70s. I feel like this is the common path for the Olympic athlete. It's like you're like a child prodigy of whatever sport, because it, like, you ever notice like everyone is like just 18 or whatever the like bare minimum age, like, because their bodies are like freaking like just amazing at sports. It's like, because you're not old yet and you don't get like tired and shitty.
You don't have creaky knees and things like that.
Yeah, you don't have a bunch of injuries and all this.
And it does seem to be a common thread that a lot of these people, yeah, they start at a very young age, you know, and you always hear the stories, all I ever wanted to do was this, you know?
And the other thing is like, if there's like a comeback story and they're old in quotes, they're like 27 or something. Like, it's like, oh, well, what a geezer. Like,
yeah, like
playing Olympic. Yeah.
Michael Phelps, the last time he was good or
like,
whatever.
Whoa, he's so old.
He's like 29.
Yeah, it's like, calm down.
Since returning to competition in April, the 29-year-old has competed in 4 meets.
So in 1987, at age 18, Nancy Kerrigan placed 4th place in the juniors at the United States Figure Skating Championships. That's like the big amateur figure skating tournament.
I remember that one. That one used to air. Like,
yeah,
it did. Yeah.
That right one before was like the Olympics.
On TV. They're like, this is going to decide who gets to go to the thing. Right?
Absolutely right, Quinn.
Last year, Nancy placed 4th in juniors in the U.S. Nationals.
And she continued to rise, and she placed 3rd in the 91 U.S. Nationals.
Next skater is Nancy Kerrigan here at the Target Center in Minneapolis. Nancy trying to make the World Championships in 3rd place after the original program.
And she was on the 1991 World Figure Skating Team. This is amongst all different countries, obviously. She was part of a sweep, and the first sweep by the U.S. on the ladies' team with her teammates, Christy Yamaguchi,
right,
and Tanya Harding.
In second place, skyrocketing Tanya Harding, with every skater's wish, a gold medal here in Munich.
So let's establish Tanya now.
Yeah.
We got that Nancy's good, right? She's
right
on this world-class team.
But Tanya's more like the redheaded stepchild. Like, she
quite literally.
She always was, like, right? She was never, like, the best, but she's, like, good enough.
The way this is boiled down to, in the public conscience, was Nancy was the anointed princess, America's sweetheart.
Golden girl, yeah.
Right, like, and Tanya was this, like
the jank, like,
blue-collar.
Hillbilly, like, yeah.
And neither are really true, to be fair, though.
Right.
Nancy Kerrigan had a blue-collar upbringing as well.
See, here's the thing, is I feel like because they you know, after the whole incident, obviously they were going to villainize Tanya.
Yes,
they,
like, rightfully so.
They, like, hillbillied her up and, like, they really, like, put this reputation of, like, lives in a trailer park and all this stuff.
They
right?
did.
Like, they laid that on her thick.
And some would say unfairly.
Yeah.
You know, like, you don't need to personally attack the person despite the circumstance. But anyway, Nancy Kerrigan and Tanya Harding had actually known each other since 1986.
Mm-hmm.
They were friendly with each other. They were on the same teams.
Do you think Nancy Kerrigan's a bitch?
No, I don't.
Is she really a nice person?
Yeah, she's nice.
Because there was always that, you know, I guess people think, well, they're these two girls and they're competing and there's a cat fight. And I mean, I think a lot of it is the soap opera drama that people think, well, there must be a...
Everybody thinks that it's like a soap opera, you know. I mean, but Nancy and I have been, you know, teammates for many, many years. And we've been on tour 3 different years in a row. And, you know, it's everybody does everything together.
So Tanya was born a year after. She was born in November of 70. She's from Portland, Oregon, not the South.
Mm-hmm.
This is why it's like a funny characterization. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
She's from friggin' Portland. What's up there? Trees and Billy Jack Haynes.
I mean, it's like any other.
Wasn't Portlandia back then.
All I'm saying,
Quinn,
is they can just portray it as other side of the tracks. It doesn't matter what state
well,
you're
that's
from.
True.
Like,
that's
you know,
a good
point. There's always like the not as well to do area.
Fair enough, like, Quinn. Yeah, and she did have a very difficult upbringing. All credit to her. She began skating even earlier than Nancy Kerrigan. She began skating at age 3.
Wow, that's really early.
Early, man. She actually dropped out of high school at age 16 to focus on her skating. Now, there's a lot of details about Tanya Harding that we're going to leave out here, because you can either watch that movie I, Tanya, that came out about 6 years ago with Margot Robbie portraying her. And some of that is dramatized, obviously.
Of course it is.
But by a lot of accounts, she had a very difficult upbringing. Her mother could be very difficult. A lot of things that we're just not mentioning here because we're focusing on a specific story.
Right.
I just want to be clear about that. But anyway, in 1986, with regards to skating, she placed 6th in the U.S. Figure Skating Championship, 5th place in 87 and 88, 3rd place in 89. So make no bones about it, Tonya Harding was a damn good skater.
Of course.
It's not like she was some jabroni.
Here's the thing, is it's the Olympics. It's like, you wouldn't be here if you weren't like at least pretty good at this.
Right. Yeah. This is not some guy sitting at the bar that's like, oh, I could do that.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
No, you can't.
Like, the thing with the Olympics is it's like the best of the best, right? It's even the like lower ranks are like better than normal humans at any of this.
Better than the lay person, if you will, right? She became the first American to perform a triple axel in 1991. Now, I am not, believe it or not, a figure skating expert.
Fucking shocker.
All I know is that an axel is pretty common.
It's like a triple spin. Like, you do a jump and you like
a forward jump and
like a spin in air three times and it's like really hard. And I remember like the men could like achieve the quadruple axel because they were like a little bit stronger.
It's very hard.
It's all like body strength. So like you literally like it's like biologically based, basically. Like, it's one of those.
But to pull off a triple, that hadn't even happened until the 80s. And Tani was one of the earlier people to do a triple.
Right.
That was insane.
Now the question is whether she will become the first American to attempt and complete a triple axel jump. We will know that here, whether she tries it or not. Good girl! Oh, isn't that great? The first time an American, only Midori Ito, has completed a triple axel in competition. Oh, how nice! How terrific!
This is not Axl Rose, by the way. We're not that Axl.
Oh, Guns N' Roses, okay, that Axl!
I was watching something recently, and there is like a band move that this woman did recently where she literally did like a backflip and landed on one foot. And it's like it's apparently like a band maneuver in skating, but it's another like, wow, you have to have like an insane amount of strength. And on top of it, you have to have the strength to land on the leg without breaking it on top of it. This is
such a hard sport.
Right.
Let's be real.
You're on ice doing flips and you're going to land and not slip and fall on your face.
100%.
Or break a bone. Like, you know, like you're on ice, right? So like when you land, you could easily bend the wrong way and snap. That's it.
Yeah.
Right?
I mean, ice is hard.
Right.
This is a very technical show.
When they're spinning around on there, none of that is easy. Like, it's really hard to do.
How much more baseline can we describe this?
Yeah.
By the way, when the ice is hard and when they're spinning around.
Well, I think it's difficult. Like a disrespected sport in a certain way. Like
it is.
It's paid
no mind.
Yeah. It's like, it's just dancing or something. Like, you know,
ice dancing.
It's ice dancing and it's not really serious.
It's fucking hard.
It's not running a marathon or doing any, you know.
Good Lord, does this look difficult though? I'm dead serious.
But it's like you are burning like a lot of energy in a very short amount of time.
Sure you are. Sure. You know? Absolutely. So in 1991, Tonya was on the aforementioned U.S. team in the World Championship with Christy Yamaguchi and Nancy Kerrigan. And in the 92 Winter Olympics, she finished fourth. She had actually twisted her ankle.
Which, again, very common. Very easily could happen in these situations.
Yep.
That's the same type of fall that she took during practice yesterday.
So again, Tanya was damn good. It's not like she was some slob that just happened to make it here. She was really good.
Yeah.
Now, again, I mentioned that she had known Nancy Kerrigan since 86. They were on the same teams. They traveled together. They were friendly. There was no real animosity. The rivalry, which, as Quinn mentioned earlier, was already being painted in the buildup to the U.S. Nationals and the Olympics in 93. That was more of like a media creation.
Mm-hmm.
It won't be a true crown until I get my chance with Nancy, and that'll be Olympics, and let me tell you, I'm gonna whip her butt.
They're just two fucking good skaters, so it's natural to think that there's some big rivalry.
You know how these things work too, where it's like they're hoping, like, we really hope that the way the brackets and all this shit work out, that they're facing head to head for like who has the most points.
Yeah, right.
Like in the leaderboards or whatever.
And that they get the gold and the silver respectively.
Right, yeah.
Right? Because again, these are two highly competitive people. They're about the same age. They're both American. They could both represent the US.
Not to mention there's always the we talked about age before, but there's always like a prime. And the both of
They're
them
in
were
early 20s.
They were like that's the prime. Like
in early 20s,
like,
yeah.
Like, you know, next Olympics they would have been too old.
Yeah, probably.
Like it's one of those. Like it's now or never, right? Which adds to the pressure.
And what also added to this too, Quinn, is that going into the 94 Olympics, Christy Yamaguchi had turned pro, so that took her out of the equation.
Right. So and if you're wondering, what pro? Why wouldn't she? In figure skating, there's this weird thing. I remember this from back then. Like, once you go pro, you can make money, and that's like,
yes.
So what they do
that's
is
professionals
they go like touring, and like they're in like professional competitions where it's like the winner gets money and stuff.
Right.
So
like most other sports,
but like in the, it's like college sports with the Olympics where it's yeah. like, oh, you can't make money doing
this. Are you kidding me? Yeah, like, this is free.
Yeah. This is for the accolades. This is like the Nobel Prize or something. You can't make money.
That's
doing
a good
this.
Way to put yeah, it though. Yeah. It really yeah. is though. That's for like the nobility and the honor of the Olympics.
Right.
It
you,
is.
You don't make money.
Although you do get like endorsement deals after the fact usually.
I think what they do is the endorsements are to pay for their travel and stuff. There's probably like limitations or whatever. There's probably like rules by
yeah,
the Olympic
fucking
committee.
IOC.
It's like you can only make this much and the rest maybe has to go into trust or like you know how
trust.
You know what I mean? Like you can't touch it until you go pro. Like some nonsense like that.
That's why you need Teddy Roosevelt because he was the trust buster.
Yeah.
You know what I
yeah,
mean? And someone
definitely.
Had to bust the trust.
I don't even know. I just made that trust up, but
it makes
sense based on like all their silly like you can only make this much money and blah blah blah.
Folks, we should just disclaim this is an entertainment podcast. Mm-hmm. Neither of us are journalists nor experts in figure skating.
Right.
Who used
and,
to commentate
and like
that?
IOC
Tesh?
Like
yeah.
rules.
Yeah, we don't know. Don't ask us
about drug testing or anything.
We don't know anything.
Yeah.
Something with George Steinbrenner. I don't know. Remember he was on the Olympic committee?
Was he? That seems like something he would be involved in.
Because his whole deal when he got suspended in 90, he had like worded a certain way with Faye Vincent, I think was the commissioner that suspended
uh-huh.
him. Faye. He's like, I don't want it to affect my Olympic standing, so we have to word it this way. They're like, fine, but you're banned for life.
It is 1-0 Yankees. We're in the top of the fourth. I don't know how to exactly report this while doing a ball game, but I'm going to try. Today, baseball commissioner Faye Vincent announced that Yankee owner George Steinbrenner had agreed to resign on or before August 29th as managing general partner of the club for his dealings with gambler Howard Spira.
That suspension is so weird because it was like only a couple years. Like it's like three.
Yeah.
It wasn't even anything.
Wasn't. One day we'll talk about George Steinbrenner. But anyway, so Christy Yamaguchi is pro. You take her out of the equation and it's even more tantalizing.
So there's only two left.
To have this one-on-one rivalry.
Now there's usually always like a Russian or some other person.
Oh, there's Japan.
Yeah, like some like other savants at figure skating involved in this.
100%. But you also have to remember the U.S. figure skating championships, the ladies' singles, they were scheduled for before the Olympics, January 7th to be exact, at the Joe Louis Arena in Detroit. The Olympics were scheduled to begin February 12th in Lillehammer, Norway. So the incident, one day before the U.S. Nationals, January 6th, 1994, Nancy Kerrigan was practicing at Cobo Hall in Detroit. Now, you've heard of Cobo Hall. Not a good place if you're an athlete. That's where Hulk Hogan pushed the Giant off the roof.
Oh, right. Yeah, that's the monster truck match.
You can't be doing this, you know?
The Giant has got Hulk Hogan on the edge of the roof of Cobo Hall. No! No!
Oh, my God.
No!
Oh, no. Help! Help!
No!
Now, what was interesting is because of all the hype, there was a lot of media attention even to these types of things, even to the practices and stuff, right? To Nancy Kerrigan doing warm-ups. And she happened to be filmed during the practice. You can find this footage on YouTube, of course, folks. It's so you've probably seen it before. It's widely available. She was practicing at the rink in Kobo. Camera crew was there. And she had finished practicing and walked into the hallway. The camera stopped filming because naturally she's done, right? Yeah. And then something happened, and the cameras came back on, and we'll give you a little bit of the audio here, folks.
What happened?
That's Nancy Kerrigan.
Yeah.
Why?
There it is.
Why? And some hard plastic.
So, we'll talk more about this, obviously, as we go on, but the bottom line is she was attacked right in between that camera going off and the camera going back on.
Right after she went through the curtain.
It's a matter of like seconds that the camera missed it.
And they nailed her and like scooted off. Like you didn't even like see who did it.
So someone
didn't even see it happen.
No, like, you
don't even see it happen. It wasn't even captured.
Something really, really hard. Help me.
So someone attacked her, what we find out, with like a telescoping baton, like a police-style baton, right on the right leg, the right thigh, and then ran the fuck out of Cobo Hall. So she was left injury-wise with a bruised knee and a bruised quad.
Mm-hmm.
And because the U.S. Nationals were the next day, she had to pull out of them.
Right.
Now, before we go into this further, I know, and I'm guilty of it more than anybody. I used to play it on our old show. The why thing. It's yeah. It's such an easy soundbite to make fun of.
Yeah, because it's like a shrill and a...
Why?
Yeah, but it's like a natural reaction. Like,
think about what happened to her.
Like, well, because you also, like, you have to remember, A, she got attacked, which is just a traumatizing thing in general. But B, she's probably also spinning through her head, like, how am I going to, like, skate?
Exactly.
And, like, I've worked my whole life for this. It's like a bunch of things, like, coming together, and she's just naturally reacting to it.
Yeah.
Right?
Let's not overlook the fact... It's a legitimate question.
Yeah.
Why?
Why? Yeah.
Why? Why did I just get attacked?
But I always thought it was more of a, why did this happen to me?
Yeah,
like
right.
That, like it's like a puzzled, like why? Why? Like, it's not even, she's not even thinking of, like, we got to get him. And, like, you know, like, she's just, like, she's just totally out of it.
Literally,
like,
why?
Why has this happened to me?
Why?
And we are going to find out why, because the search was on. Should we take a break now? I think we'll take a break now. We'll leave you in a little bit of suspense here.
The police sirens are going, yeah. And they're trying to find the guy or girl even. They don't even know. Nobody
knows.
What it is. It's a big mystery at this point.
And folks, we're going to try to solve that mystery of why, but also who, and all that more. That's going to be coming up on the other side of the ice here when more Acid Wash Memories returns.
Kerrigan claims the skating establishment and the media have long been biased against Harding because she comes from a poor background. His latest newsletter has numerous references to favoritism for Kerrigan and bias against Harding.
She would skate at a level of excellence that would not be reflected in her marks. She would be uninvited to tournaments that she was perfectly qualified to be in so that other more favored people would not be upstaged.
Heron claims the world of figure skating is like a beauty pageant where people who criticize get retaliation. He says that's what's happened to Tanya Harding.
Winning a gold medal is the dream of tens of thousands of American girls. Olympic hopefuls practice up to 60 hours a week, and training can cost $75,000 a year. Nancy Kerrigan seemed on the verge of Olympic gold until last week's violent attack.
I would like to begin by saying how sorry I am about what happened to Nancy Kerrigan. I am embarrassed and ashamed to think that anyone close to me could be involved.
I'd like a big hot baked potato with sour cream and chives.
Mm, so would I. That sounds great.
And some chili, a big steaming bowl.
Yes, chili would be perfect today. It's cold out there.
Well?
Well, what? Can't get that here. You have to go to Wendy's. Next, please.
At Wendy's, we give you delicious food you can't get anywhere else, like our rich and meaty chili and hot baked potato covered with sour cream and chives. Just 99 cents each on our super value menu.
It's everything you'd expect from Wendy's.
And now we return to more Acid Washed Memories.
And welcome back to Acid Washed Memories, episode number 54. Today we're talking about Nancy Kerrigan and Tanya Harding from 1994. I'm Joe Morata. That's Michael Quinn.
Hi.
Hi. Quinn, why?
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 We're at the sad part of the story right now. The like, oh, she just got hit. She doesn't know what happened. Just like... got her senses knocked out of her. She's like, what's going on here?
It is very sad. Folks, hey, like we mentioned, you can listen to other stuff that we talk about, too. It's not just like the Olympics.
Yeah.
That's not regular we do that.
We always talk about
the Olympics. Yeah, every week is just the Olympics.
The Olympic podcast, Acid Wash Memories.
Next week, Sean White. I mean, all sorts of stuff. But in all seriousness, you can check out our episodes in the archives. You can tell your friends, because this is fun stuff, I think.
Yeah.
We try to tell stories here and give you history.
This is like a pop culture touchstone. Like, this is like one of those like very pop cultural things.
Well, because like we were saying earlier, This was all over for, I'm not for a long time,
right?
But like every day for weeks and weeks.
Well, this is kind of like during the age of like quick tabloid story.
Oh,
like,
God, yeah.
Like Joey Buttafuoco.
It's and exactly. Like, and Lorena Bobbitt.
Lorena Bobbitt. Yep. Like all that kind of nonsense.
It's that bullshit.
Like, yeah, it's all
it
that.
It all happened at once.
There was all this. There was like, I don't know, like if people didn't grow up during this period, this early 90s period, there was this like weird spray of the tabloids finding these like really fucking weird stories of people yeah. like doing some terrible thing to somebody. And like, it's always like, you ever notice it's nobody died, but it's like enough to like get somebody thrown in prison.
Well, someone's dick gets cut off.
Yeah, it's or... like, it's something like that's like pretty shitty.
Yeah, no shit.
But it doesn't involve murder.
Like, right, right. Like, that's, like, that's heavy.
That's a step too far.
That's
for
a different. Like, that'd be Waco or right, some Emberton
yeah,
correction.
Yeah,
all
like
that.
that's like to me the class of story we're talking. It usually involves like sleazy people of some
right.
kind.
Like this is less Ted Coppoly and more Inside Edition-y.
Right. Yes. Yes. Exactly.
It's empty calories.
Yeah.
Because if you really think about it, besides the principles involved, the average American is like, it doesn't affect them at all. Like, this is not... This
it's
is
still,
not...
at the end of the day, though, an assault. Like, it's an actual,
oh,
like...
No,
it's
shit.
It's
yeah.
like an actual, like, if they find the person who did this, they're in big trouble, mister.
And we have to find these people, because right. this is our job to find
right.
them. But before we do that, we're going to find us on Twitter at AWM Podcast. And please join our Facebook group. And I got one more request, if you don't mind. Maybe pause the show, or even while you're listening to it, go to your favorite podcast app that you're listening on, and leave us a review.
Yeah.
We would really like
that.
That
would be nice.
That would be nice. Okay. Let's get back to the ice. So, as we mentioned, January 6, 94, cameras are rolling. Nancy Kerrigan finishing up a routine practice on the eve mm-hmm. of the U.S. Figure Skating Championship, goes through the curtain, cameras cut out, they turn back on, and she's on the floor crying, and we find out she's been attacked by some clown with a police baton.
You know what's fascinating about this, if you think about it? How the fuck did that guy, or, you know, whoever did this, how did they know to strike at that exact time where the cameras were off and everything? Like, that's kind of okay. like, that's crazy, actually. Like, that's actually well planned, if you think about it.
I will explain it. Okay. Yeah. So what we would later find out is the attack itself, the physical act of doing it,
right,
was carried out by a man named Shane Stant.
Shane Stant surrendered to the FBI in Phoenix today. He is suspected of clubbing Kerrigan in the knee.
And he had turned himself in to the FBI.
That's a big boy.
Only a matter of days later, a week later, on January 14th, Shane Stant is the one that had the police baton, dressed uh-huh. in all black. He attacked Nancy Kerrigan.
Did he have some kind of hood on so they couldn't see his face?
Yeah, of course. And what he did is he was right behind the cameraman the whole time.
Mm.
And as soon as he saw the cameraman put the camera down,
he went to take his shot.
Exactly. Now, the idea, for the record here, was to injure her worse than he actually did, like break her leg or something. The idea was to really, really hurt her.
This really does sound like some mafia crap.
It does.
Like, right? It's like, we're going to break your legs. Like, but, that kind of thing.
Literally,
yeah.
right? But again, low level.
Yeah.
And this guy looks like a chooch.
It's
I mean,
like, what are we going to find out? Nancy Kerrigan had a gambling debt or something?
Right. Like, she knew a guy who knew a guy, and yeah. the guy wasn't happy.
Shut up.
It's just the nature of the attack, the legs aspect. It's like it feels very mafia.
I think it's more to do with the skating aspect, though,
yeah.
I think. But anyway, one of the people that hired this man, Shane Stant, to carry out the attack was a guy named Sean Eckerd.
Also charged, Sean Eckerd, who allegedly confessed to planning the attack.
Now, Sean Eckhard, he...
Look
looks like Del Griffith.
Look at this, man. He looks like John Candy.
Exactly. But...
Well, you think what you want about me. I'm not changing. I like me.
If John Candy was alive when they made the Tonya Harding movie, he would have definitely played this guy. There's no doubt about it.
Folks,
I'm gonna grow a mustache. And,
he did. That's Planes, Trains, John Candy.
Yeah,
right there.
That's him right there.
It is. But anyway.
very big in Sheboygan.
Very big in Sheboygan. He's shower curtain rings.
Yeah.
So Sean Eckerd had spoken to another man who is a little less important, but still important here, named Derek Smith.
How many layers?
Too
like,
many.
This is crazy.
Way too many for what this is. So Derek Smith and Sean Eckerd plan the attack. They're the ones that hired Shane Stant to do
right.
the actual
so Shane Stant was
work.
Just basically a hitman.
Yeah, like, heavy. Yeah, 100%.
He was just a gun for hire.
Exactly, or a yeah. baton in yeah. this case.
Stop it!
But also, Derek Smith happened to be Sean Eckhart's uncle.
Hmm.
Okay, so Del Griffith over here.
Yeah.
His uncle was involved. Okay. Very uncle behavior, by the way.
Oh, this is uncle-y. This is very uncle-y.
Avuncular, if you will. But that's not all, Quinn.
No.
Because this man, Sean Eckard, also happened to be Tonya Harding's bodyguard at the time.
Uh-oh.
Also, the explosive charges from Harding's bodyguard, Sean Eckard, in his only television interview.
What did Tonya Harding know about the attack on Nancy Kerrigan?
She knew that it was, that it had been initiated.
We're getting closer to the
The onion is peeling back and it stinks.
Yeah. we're almost like touching the actual skater, the competitor. Here.
So what we find out is that the payment here to carry out this attack was $6,500.
It's kind of low.
I know. I know.
Well, let's think about this, though, for by inflationary standards.
That's a good point.
Like,
let's find out what that would be.
What
would that be? Again, investigative journalism here.
Maybe like $15,000 now, something like that. That's actually like a pretty good payday, actually, if you think about it.
About 14 grand.
Yeah.
Okay, five figures.
That's a decent payday.
Yeah, listen to us analyzing the payday of a police baton attack on a figure skater.
I'm just saying, like, was it worth his while or not?
Yeah, I'd say it was probably, right?
Because you got to pay somebody a good figure to, like, do something like this. Nope. I mean, they're putting their ass on the line here.
No pun intended.
Yeah.
Figure skating.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Fucking funny. Why don't you go figure out how to shut the fuck up? And don't call my show.
Now, Shane Stant, remember, break your leg guy. The goon. He was originally going to do this in Nancy Kerrigan's home area of Cape Cod, Massachusetts.
It's probably riskier, I would think, because then it's a break-in at that point.
Well, not in literally in her home, but in a skating rink.
Oh, okay.
In December of 93, but he couldn't find her.
Huh.
Now, from what I understand, I haven't seen the movie in full, but I've seen clips.
I haven't seen it since it came out. I don't even remember.
The movie I, Tonya portrays everyone involved in this as very bumbling and like inept, and they might be.
Well, I mean, considering how like quickly they all got caught, obviously, like somebody didn't plan this out. Like, you would think, like,
it ain't exactly JFK.
But if this was well arranged, the hitman would never give up his connection.
That's a good point.
Right? Like, he would be paid to not do that.
This is very small time.
Right.
It's very Bush.
Right. Exactly. Like, again, if a mafia hitman got caught, he wouldn't tell you that the mafia hired him.
No, that's like, not what you do. Because they'll kill you.
Because they'll kill you. Exactly. You will die. Like you. That's how they do it. Right.
They're very wise.
But these guys are just bumbling dope. So immediately Sean's like, oh yeah, someone paid me to do this. Who
My
paid
uncle's
you?
Involved.
This guy. It's like, oh okay. And then they go ask him, and he's like, oh, don't arrest me. Okay, this guy paid me to do it. Like, and it's so terrible.
And that's the biggest thing about this attack. Although we have Derek Smith, the uncle, although we have Sean Eckard, Del Griffith, mm-hmm. although we have the actual physical heavy, Shane Stant, the mastermind, from what everyone understood, was a fella by the name of Jeff Galooly.
What a name.
Jeff Galooly turned himself into the FBI. He has been charged with conspiracy to assault Nancy Kerrigan.
This guy,
the name I will never forget.
First of all, before even talking about the way he looks,
I mean,
he just looks like somebody that would do this,
right?
I gotta say,
is it the mustache? Would you say
it's the mustache?
Yeah.
When you're 8 years old, you don't ask or aspire to learn the name Jeff Galooly.
Well,
it is just,
it was forced upon me.
Yeah, incessantly pounded upon you on the news, and it just burns into your memory. Jeff Galooly.
Now, this dude, right, he's Tonya's boyfriend or something?
Oh, like, it's great, Quinn.
What is that? What is his connection? I know it's, like, very weird.
So, he happened to be Tonya Harding's husband, but they were estranged at the time, but they were still together.
Okay.
Okay, so, again, I'm trying to spare some details here.
What does that
here.
Mean? Like, they weren't sleeping together, but they lived together? Or, like, what, like I don't even, like, estranged, but living?
It's
but,
all
but,
fucked.
Yeah, that doesn't make any sense.
Again, I want to spare some details here, because they're not pleasant. But basically, they had met when he was 17 and she was 15, which is in the mid-80s, obviously. They had some domestic altercations throughout the years. He seems to be somewhat of a violent, erratic person.
Right.
Okay. Further adding to the whole media portrayal of Tonya Harding.
Right.
Right. Again, probably not completely fairly on her part. But anyway, He doesn't seem like a good, upstanding man, is what I'm saying. And maybe the mustache is part of that perception.
It's possible.
But it is a suspicious mustache.
Now, I guess the important question with all this, I think the juicy bit that everyone wanted to know at the time was, did Tanya ask Jeff Galluli to do this, or was she, like, in any way, like, asked for this to happen? Like, you know what I'm saying? Or did this guy, like, was he just an idiot, basically, and he thought he was, like, doing her a favor asking her?
See, this is the big question that still is truly on a legal end. It's not answered. So, Tanya Harding, because this is very quick, all the turn-ins and all the FBI getting involved, Tanya Harding has to speak to this, right?
Mm-hmm.
And she denies knowing anything about it.
Right.
Denies being involved, denies having any foreknowledge.
Did you have prior knowledge of the planned attack on Nancy Kerrigan?
No, I did not.
Absolutely not.
Absolutely not.
I know you can't discuss the facts of the case, but in your statement that you read to reporters, you said, I learned that some persons close to me were involved in the assault.
Yes.
Why didn't you go to authorities immediately?
Everything just happened so fast.
Let's think about this for a second. If they're, like, estranged or whatever, there is a possibility that she really didn't know anything about it. On the other hand, she's really close to the situation. How could she not? So it's like you kind of have to balance those two, and it really just depends. I mean, there's just one truth to it. It's she did or she didn't.
That, like, there can only be one possibility, right? It does look, on the face of it, let's be completely honest here, on the face of it, it looks like she knew, right? Because it's her ex, but current husband,
right?
Her bodyguard, and those other two bozos, right?
Mm-hmm.
But they're seen together in the aftermath of this, and then the lead up to it, Tanya and Jeff Galluli. It's not like they're not on speaking terms.
Trying to sound upbeat, Tanya Harding and her husband Jeff Galluli talked briefly with reporters staked outside their home.
Not only that, it wasn't like some random person got attacked. Who got attacked?
Very specific, like, the only person standing in her way from being the champion.
Correct. And it's not just the Olympics coming up. There was also the U.S. figure skating championship.
Right.
So Tanya Harding denied it. The story, as we all know, blew up immediately on the news.
Well, because like how we just asked the question, we put it on two sides ourselves, and we said it could be she really didn't know, and these guys are just idiots, and they thought they were helping her. Or
right.
It could be that she planned the whole thing.
Correct.
And that the whole point of them is to be a buffer between her.
Or at the in-between is that she didn't plan it. It was their idea, but she acquiesced to it.
Right. She said, I wouldn't mind.
Right.
I wouldn't
care. She knew and she endorsed it.
Yeah.
Right. It's all possible. Now, not that I accuse the media of having scruples almost ever. Right. Because you know what their job is. They're there to make money and create headlines, blah, blah, blah. But you got to pounce on this. Right. Because it's too tasty not to, right?
Right.
If we're being honest.
Yeah.
The fig, not only is a figure skater attacked, but maybe her rival was behind it.
But it's a very easy question to pose to the American public that they can jump to their own conclusions on both sides.
That's the other thing.
And then you get two subsects of people that we just basically described. Some that, she didn't know, like, her boyfriend's just an idiot. Or like, she definitely knew. She was still with him.
I think that, in all seriousness, if I really think about it, I think Tanya would have looked a lot more innocent if Jeff Galluli did not have that mustache.
Well, yeah, there's that.
I think it just hurts
also,
his case.
Why the fuck are they with each other after the fact? Like, that was her first mistake.
Right.
If she, like, say even she did plan it, right?
Right.
Like, I would not even, like, go near this guy until, like, the dust had cleared.
Absolutely.
Right?
And why was her bodyguard involved? And then she tried to say, like, he wasn't a bodyguard and he sucked
her.
The whole thing was a tangled mess, but from the media's point of view, and what we were force-fed, as kids, is this is the national travesty, the biggest thing to ever happen.
Yeah, they did act, like, here's the thing, if you were there, they really did act like this was, like, Jimmy Hoffa getting killed or something. Like, this was, like, the biggest thing to ever happen.
Seriously,
like,
though.
You know, the Congress is going to have to investigate. Like, this is so big.
Newt Gingrich might get involved.
Yeah, it's like, we might need to ask the president about this. Like, we might need to see what he thinks.
What Bill Clinton thinks
yeah,
of all
yeah.
this.
Like, these are all very important things.
Oh, man, yeah.
What is the governor of the state where this happened? What are his leads telling us?
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Like, what is he, I feel like they were asking important people, like,
they
to
were.
Weigh in on this shit. Like, it mattered that much.
It was a huge deal for a brief period of time. And you know what? The unintended side effect of all of this is that it brought ladies figure skating to a level of unprecedented prominence, Quinn.
So I think the immediate side effect was whatever the next skating thing was, is like everyone was watching
the U.S. Nationals.
Like the thing
yep.
where Tanya was in it.
Yes.
Like suddenly everyone's like, she got the nerve to go out there?
And
like
she
that
did.
Was like that was the real, like, people couldn't fucking believe that she didn't, like, bow out.
And guess what? Not only did she go, she won.
Yeah, well, I mean, there was no competition.
Tanya Harding is the 1994 national champion.
A little suspicious, can we say?
Yes, I don't... Did she have a fucking lawyer? Like seriously, at this point, I would get a lawyer and be like, should I, like, do this? Like, should I, like, go to the Olympic thing?
Or, she did,
like,
it, man.
Should I even do any of this? Like,
I mean,
where was a lawyer in all of this situation?
She wasn't told not to. I just want to, again, reiterate, look up Jeff Galuli and you'll see what I mean, okay?
Yeah.
But anyway, so Tanya, conveniently, without Nancy Kerrigan in the U.S. Nationals, she wins the damn thing, right? However, Nancy Kerrigan recovered, and there were Olympic practice sessions held, and she was a part of them, and the media was waiting in anticipation.
Would there be a face-to-face, I think, is what everyone wanted to know.
For a Nancy Kerrigan, Tanya Harding confrontation of any kind, because you got to understand, Olympic ice skating practices, to the best of my knowledge, are not like a big deal.
Right.
Right. Like, normally the media wouldn't be all over this.
They wouldn't give a shit.
They
already, like, slightly gave a shit before this,
they
to be
did,
fair.
Slightly. But this just magnified it. Shortly before the Olympics, Nancy Kerrigan and Tanya Harding were both at a practice session.
I remember this famous picture.
And they did briefly cross paths.
Kerrigan and Tanya Harding on the ice together. Their first joint practice session in the Olympic arena, Northern Lights Hall. There were no judges here today, but the scrutiny was intense. And last night, the decision was made to more than triple security.
They didn't talk to each other on camera that anyone saw. But one of the things that...
shot where Tanya looks guilty or something.
Yeah.
And Nancy's kind of like looking up...
Normal.
Normal, yeah.
Nancy, displaying somewhat of a twisted sense of humor intentionally, she wore the very same outfit that she was attacked in.
Right.
Just to be like, look, I'm back.
Right.
You know?
It's like, so, you didn't even get me.
And then that's to add to the buffoonery that already surrounds, like, this gang of idiots
mm-hmm.
that portrayed this.
For the record, we don't know if Tanya was part of it.
No, not
like,
her.
Like, we don't know.
I'm talking about Shane Stant and Sean Eckert.
The fat
you know,
guy and
yeah,
all that.
And Mustache yeah. McGee, right?
John Candy.
Yeah. They didn't take her out of the Olympics.
No, it didn't really, like, accomplish anything.
He just,
right?
like, he whacked her. It hurt, clearly.
Yeah.
It took her out of the next day competition.
Yeah.
She's back in the fucking Olympics.
Right. It wasn't that bad of an injury.
No.
At the end of the day.
At the end of the day, it was probably more of, like, a mental injury.
Right.
So we hit Lillehammer in Norway. And in an incredible twist of irony, Nancy Kerrigan, despite the injury, she almost got the gold, but she, like... She fucked up towards the end.
Mm-hmm.
Nancy Kerrigan got the silver.
Right.
Nancy Kerrigan skated the performance of her life. Oksana Bayul, truly special. Either way, the judging would have been fair.
But Tanya Harding, despite this whole plan, she had issues with her laces on her skates.
Yeah, I remember the crying. Oh,
the
my
irony
la-
is
my
delicious.
Laces. Oh, no. Like, right. This whole fucking thing. She's in the whole costume and everything. She's, like, ready to go, and, like, her outfit breaks or something.
Her skate lace broke.
Yeah.
They gave her a reskate.
And for the first time in this competition, Tanya Harding received a smattering of boos.
She was vilified for this. And again, moral justice was served here. I mean, that's just like poetic justice, right?
Right.
But look, can we talk about Tanya?
She did get a redo. It's not like the end of the world.
Yeah, and she finished eighth.
Yeah.
Eighth.
Mm-hmm.
After all that.
So none of it mattered.
None of it ultimately mattered. Now, before we get into the criminal charges and all mm-hmm. that, can we talk about Tanya for 1 second? If she didn't know.
If she didn't know, this really sucks.
Right.
Like, her life was basically screwed up.
Right. If she's just a pawn, an unknowing pawn, in this bullshit plan by these gang of bozos, yeah. You gotta feel for her.
I know I keep bringing it back to, like, seedy underbelly and stuff like that, right?
Yeah.
If you really think about it, considering the national spotlight that was on this, right? Even prior to the incident,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, just the rivalry.
How much do you want to bet that there was, I don't know, gambling going on, you know,
in the
underworld about this kind of shit?
Could have been.
You don't have to jump to a lot of conclusions that maybe Jeff Galooly had some money on some, and had a direct link and could have possibly affected the outcome. So right? It's like, you know what I'm saying?
Ulterior, like, motives that transcend their personal relationship. In other
exactly,
words,
yeah.
Financial gain to be had.
Right.
It's quite possible. Or the guy was just a fucking nutcase.
That too. There's a myriad of other things because we don't really know if Tanya knew.
We don't know.
So, like, there's other, like, speculations you could make about what was actually going on here.
Maybe the guy thought in his own twisted way, he pulled a Hinckley. He thought that this would be a good way to impress her.
Right. He thought, you know, hey, we're estranged right now. Maybe this will be the thing to, like, she'll really, like, love me now.
Exactly.
Right? I'll win her the Olympics.
Now that,
like, you know what I mean?
Right, right.
Like,
that's better than coming in on a white horse.
Yeah,
let's
exactly.
Be honest here. Now that's if Tanya didn't know. Then I have sympathy for her.
What's funny, what's ironic is what I wonder, what if, nothing had ever happened,
mm-hmm.
what if Tanya would have gotten the silver and Nancy would have gotten the gold, and that still would have been a pretty fucking good turnout.
Right, like, exactly. For both. And they're on the same team, technically.
Yeah.
That's the other thing. They're on the United States Olympic team.
Right. There was really no purpose to her doing this.
I know. So let's talk about the criminal charges. Jeff Galooly, our good friend, and Sean Eckerd, they pleaded guilty to racketeering. That's the charge here, is racketeering. Whereas Shane Stant, the heavy that carried it out, reminding everyone, and Derek Smith, the uncle, they pled guilty to conspiracy to commit second-degree assault.
Right.
So in March of 94, Tanya Harding herself...
Wait, nobody just got straight assault charges? Because, like, there was an actual
These are plea bargains, that's why.
Well, yeah, and I guess, if they were plea bargains, it never actually went to trial. So, actually, correct. That guy got a lot less than he should have.
Yeah, and that's why they've realized, what the fuck have we done here? And they all just kind of did plea bargains, including Tanya Harding. She pled guilty to conspiracy to hinder prosecution.
Saying she didn't know about the attack on Nancy Kerrigan before it happened, but she did know details about the attack within days after it happened, and she admitted she did not go to police to tell them what she knew.
So they got her on that. They worked out a plea deal where conspiracy to hinder prosecution, but with the condition, Quinn, and this actually is important, she would not be subject to any further prosecution.
No double
down the
jeopardy.
Line. Correct.
It's over after this.
Yep.
Now, question.
Yep.
Did anyone actually go to jail for this?
Yeah. Jeff Galooly, I forget the others off the top of my head. Jeff Galooly, I think, was sentenced to 2 years.
2 years.
I think he has since changed his name to Jeff Stone.
That's a good call.
That's all over the news.
That's a name you'll never forget.
Jeff Galooly.
As soon as he applies for a job or something, you're Jeff Galooly. You know what I'm saying? Like, you don't want to. That's not a name that you want to have.
You want to. You want to bet that he shaved that mustache when he came
Absolutely.
Out.
Absolutely,
100%. Jeff, hi, I'm Jeff Stone.
Hi,
can I have a job?
Yeah,
sure. You're Jeff Galooly.
What a mess all of this was.
A mess is a good way to put it. Weeks after Tanya's plea bargain in March of '94, the Portland, Oregon grand jury issued an indictment, and this indictment stated that there was evidence that Tanya Harding fraudulently used United States Figure Skating Association monies to finance the assault.
So wait a sec, though. If they don't even know if she did it, then how do they know that?
This is the indictment. It also read that Tanya Harding, Jeff Galooly, Sean Eckert, Derek Smith, and Shane Stant agreed to knowingly cause physical injury by means of a dangerous weapon. However, Tanya was not charged in the indictment.
Well, that's because she did the plea on the other thing where they said, we won't, this is it. You pleaded this or you're out.
Now, why would she agree to that?
I don't know.
Maybe because she
knew. Did she know? She could have known that these charges were coming.
That's what I'm saying.
Right.
Wouldn't you fight for that shit? think.
I don't know.
Let's think about it.
Would you? Like, would you just
Who doesn't fight for their innocence, man?
Well, here's the thing, right? The way I wonder when you're in this position that you think, right?
Yeah.
Is like, if someone puts an offer on the table that says, no jail time and nothing further, no matter what the hell it is, because there could be stuff like 5 years down the line that you don't even foresee.
True. Well, that's fair, Quinn.
Wouldn't you just take it?
That's like, fair, Quinn.
You know what I mean?
That's fair.
It's like I basically got away with nothing. Like nothing happened to me. I paid a fine or something, probably.
Nothing happened to her that much on a criminal level. However, over the summer of 94, the United States Figure Skating Association stripped Tanya Harding of her 1994 title.
Of course, yeah.
And barred her from ever skating for them again.
Yeah, and fair. That, to me, that's the real punishment because that was her livelihood.
And she was good.
Yeah, like that... Because then it's like, now you can't really turn pro because you're disgraced.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, you could, but like, who the fuck would come to see you?
Who wants you? Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, exactly.
I think that's their due diligence to do such a thing. Do you not?
I think ultimately, like, kind of everything, as far, everyone got like the suitable punishment, it appears at least.
I think so. Yeah. You know, this is a really bizarre story.
It's kind of just, it's an incident, if you will, because it's just so random and strange and like just not how this shit usually works at all.
No, and especially the juxtaposition of a violent act in the sport of figure skating,
mm-hmm.
you know, which is a beautiful art form.
Yeah, I've never been able to understand like how something like this could happen. Like, it's just bizarre. Like, it's not even like a... It's not like I think I stay up at night and think about it or anything,
but it's just
one of those things when I think back to it, it's just like, that really freaking happened, and that's just weird in general.
It really was weird. As far as the epilogue of Nancy Kerrigan, she would go on to turn pro after the 94
Olympics. I remember that.
Olympics.
Yeah, she was always like famous because of this. Like, basically, like she
famous, yeah.
became the big. She became a big star because people. She was even more the golden girl, right? Like, suddenly, like the
that would be Blanche Quinn.
No, but I mean, I just mean the one, right? The figure skater that everyone knows. Isn't she's America's sweetheart, right? As like,
the irony too is that she had a couple of controversial, and I'm saying that word in quotes, comments that were filmed. One of them was at the Olympic ceremony, the medal ceremony. It was delayed because they couldn't find a copy of the Ukrainian national anthem.
Mm.
And while she was doing that, she thought, she was under the impression that it was because the gold medal winner had cried her makeup off.
Wow.
So she was caught on CBS.
Saying something mean or something.
She's like, what's the difference? Come on already. She's just going to cry her makeup off.
Nancy Kerrigan and Shen Lu thought they were waiting for Oksana Bayul to be made up.
So she's going to get out here and cry again.
In fact, it was Oksana's makeup, but also no one could find a copy of the Ukrainian national anthem.
I mean, I've also there's been other Olympic incidents where they've had a hot mic on the ceremonial stand
where somebody
said some shit. Like, I feel like that happens a lot, actually.
Kerrigan even had to be coached to smile. Now listen carefully to the off-camera voice that has to tell her to smile, honey.
Smile, honey. What's this for?
Well, this is going to be uplinked to most of the stations across the country that are eager to hear about you.
We have an attitude problem here.
We just wanted to welcome you back.
During a parade, Kerrigan complained to Mickey Mouse, "It's so corny, so dumb. I hate it. The most corny thing I've ever done."
And who could forget Michaela Maroney's face? Remember her like crooked face when she was all mad or whatever? It was like a meme. It's a meme. You know what a meme? Quinn, what is a meme?
A meme. It's like an event or a picture of something. Like, it can be all sorts of things. Like it's something where people like share it a lot.
Oh, okay.
And it becomes a thing on the internet.
Thank you very much.
I guess that's the description of it, right?
That seems accurate enough.
Seems accurate.
Nancy Kerrigan also had a brief career resurgence, or at least in the pop culture, I should say. In 2017, she was on Dancing with the Stars, a very popular program with my wife.
Right.
And
with a lot of people's wives.
Yes, a lot of people's wives.
You know, we're moving our way up slowly. That puts a little more pressure on us, but at the same time, I think that's good.
Tom Bergeron was on it for a long time. Yeah. When our Ask to Watch Memories darling, Tom Bergeron.
I don't like him.
I know, no one
does. He's our nemesis.
A few people like him.
Yeah.
That's like saying your favorite bread is white bread.
Why is Dancing with the Stars still happening? Like, it's like, how
Well, there's still stars, and they still got to dance. 25
years or something at this point. Like, it's been on forever.
Well, yeah, it has.
It's gonna go rival The Simpsons soon enough.
But Nancy Kerrigan was on it. She did well enough, I guess. Tonya Harding had a little bit of a different path, whereas Nancy Kerrigan would always be known in somewhat of a positive light, mm-hmm. right? Even if she
overcame adversity and right. like, so the America's sweetheart and blah, blah, blah.
A very beautiful woman, by the way.
Yeah, if I but may I gotta say, I feel like Nancy Kerrigan, believe it or not, for all the like, she's the best and the nicest and wow, blah, 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 like all that shit, right?
Yeah.
She was actually the one I feel like the pop culture world forgot in the end.
Well,
and really, Tonya became the long-term, like, yeah. interesting one, because everyone's like, there was always the question of did she know,
yeah.
and like all this, and it was like an endless mystery in pop culture. No,
yeah, because Tonya had a different trajectory. She had right. a somewhat of a sex tape released.
Right.
She did boxing. Remember when she was a boxer?
So there was this weird period in the late 90s, early 2000s, where I feel like Tonya was like chasing. She couldn't skate anymore, right?
Correct, yes.
So she was doing, like, almost, like, weird carny shit, basically.
Very
like,
carny.
Like, where she's just, like, doing all this second-rate, like, Z-tier celebrity stuff to,
yeah.
like, just make a living, probably, in all honesty, because, like, her meal ticket was taken away.
Welcome to Celebrity Boxing. Tonight's triple hitter includes fiery Olympic figure skater Tonya Harding.
Was she ever on those fucking VH1 shows with like Mo Rocca and Michael
Ian
Black?
She was.
Like, yo, remember Blues Traveler yeah. or whatever?
Remember the 90s? I like how I was there.
I like how we're making fun of the very thing that we do,
yeah,
by the way.
I know, but like these shows, like one of the things I disliked about those shows. We
crappy.
Should do a whole thing about those shows.
That'd
but like one
meta.
Of the things I disliked about them was like the talking heads.
Oh, they're horrible.
Like they're like, in the 90s, it was so important that you had a Tamagotchi. Like, and it's like, yeah. Shut up. Everyone knows that. Like, we know it's like Michael Ian Black or something. Like, you know what I mean?
They were like the girl Backstreet Boys, only British and with racks.
I know exactly what you mean.
And then they're like making stupid faces and they're like, oh, is this one? Oh, you have one? And like the guy passes it to him. Like, you know, like it's always the same gimmick, right?
Yeah, they're horrible.
Yeah.
Tonya also appeared on a special.
We're going to do the 70s one. Oh, you have a pet rock? Oh, wow. Is this really it? I haven't seen this since I was a kid.
Oh,
like,
Pocket Fisherman.
Yeah.
Anyway.
I love the 90s.
Tonya appeared on a 15 Minutes of Fame episode of The Weakest Link. Not only that, you know who else is on that? Fits right into this. Cato Kaelin. Same vein.
Yeah, Cato.
I think he was one of the talking heads on those shows.
Cato's another I just happen to be there kind of person. Like, yeah. Cato's not even, he's not even a participant like Tonya.
He's not
like,
anything.
Like, Cato literally just happened to be like in the thing.
Staying
next,
at OJ's guest house.
Yeah, like in the guest house when the thing happened and they had to ask him stuff and he didn't really know anything, right?
We got a lot of shit from 1994 to talk about in the coming episodes.
I mean,
I
would
think,
we ever do the OJ trial?
I don't want to do the trial, but I'd do the chase.
Yeah, the chase.
I would do that part.
It is like one of the most insane things I've ever seen.
People, yeah.
Like, ever.
Ever. Now, this is a little bit of an update in terms of information. So, this attack happened in 1994.
Right.
And for 24 years.
It's crazy it happened the same year as the OJ.
Yeah, and I believe was John Wayne Bobbitt?
Yeah.
94
it
as well.
It happened early in the year, though.
It did. But
so
a lot of
OJ
shit happened.
Hadn't happened yet. That was like April or something,
June,
right?
June. In 2008.
You mean 2018, right? This is really Quinn. I promise.
After 24 years of saying she literally knew nothing at all about it, Tonya Harding said that she had overheard or knew something was in the works about attacking somebody. And that's about as specific as she got about it.
Harding has always denied she helped plan the hit.
You never said to Jeff, let's do this.
No. No.
He never asked for your permission.
No.
And you were never part of the planning.
No. I did, however, overhear them talking about stuff where, well, maybe we should take somebody out so we can make sure she gets on the team. And I remember telling them, I go, what the hell are you talking about? I can skate.
So you heard them talking about doing something to someone before the attack on Nancy, but nothing specific.
This was like a month or 2 months before.
It's really vague, though.
Like, yeah, but do you think she knew?
I mean, you could make your own judgments there.
What do you think?
What I'm trying to say is I don't think, like, in a court of law they could, like, do anything about that. Like,
no, but what do you think?
I think she knew on a level, but maybe she didn't know all the details, or, like, maybe she didn't even know who they were going to plan to hit. Like, maybe
who else would you hit?
Maybe one of the other competitors.
Who?
Maybe the person that was third to her. I don't know, but I'm just saying, like, you know, if they were... They weren't smart, so it's kind of a weird thing to say. If they were smart about it, they would tell her, but they wouldn't say who they were going to get, right? So that she would really not know anything.
So what's so weird about it is, if she isn't involved at all, then it has to go back to, what the fuck is the motivation?
Yeah, so the motivation, right? Like, well, we tried to figure that out already, right? We tried to think that maybe Jeff Galooly's just an idiot and he was trying to get on her good graces because they were... split apart or something.
Or worse than an idiot, like fucking insane.
Insane or whatever. I don't know, but or it's just like that it, unlike like the other thing, I mean, you could really go all different directions. You could say like it was a master plan by Tonya Harding, like from the get-go that she like directed Galooly to do this.
Yeah.
Almost like, you want to get my good graces again? Do something about Nancy Kerrigan.
Take her out, right.
Or maybe that's as far as it went. Maybe she just said, do something about Nancy Kerrigan. Maybe she didn't say hit her or something.
It's possible.
You know what I mean? Like,
I find it.
You could go so many different directions with this, right?
You could.
Like, maybe she just said, made an off comment like that because there are, I've heard this before, like not this specific incident, but things like this where somebody maybe in anger or frustration said, well, I really wish you could get rid of that person.
Yeah, of course.
And then this guy fucking did it.
Right.
And she didn't really expect him to. Like, you know what I mean?
It's also possible that even if she knew about it, that it wasn't her idea.
Right.
I think that's the most likely. And again, we'll never know for sure unless she says it. And my opinion doesn't matter more than anyone else's. But what I truly think is she didn't come up with the idea, but she knew about it and didn't try to stop it.
This is one of those that I don't know what to think. Because it's just so like... It's still to this day is like rather mysterious. Like,
it is.
What level of involvement. And I'd rather just not even speculate. Like, I'd rather just think, you know, maybe there's a bunch of reasons, but nobody really knows the actual reason.
Well, that's fair. And folks, we want you to speculate, though, if you want to. You do that on Twitter at AWM Podcast or join our group. I will say this. A lot of this was muddied up in the last 6 years when I, Tonya came out and it painted... Tonya Harding in a much more sympathetic light. In 1998, as a bit of a epilogue here, there was a special on Fox known as Breaking the Ice.
The behind the scenes. We're gonna figure it all out on this 1998 special that looks really cheesy.
So a lot of it was interviews with Nancy Kerrigan, and then at one point they bring out Tonya Harding for a face to face and
with Nancy.
Yeah, and I gotta say, very awkward. Yeah. Let's take a quick peek again. You can find this on the YouTubes.
Oh, no.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Did she know they were going to bring her out?
Yeah.
How are you?
I don't like this, Joe.
Face to face. Sense.
Who's the, like...
It's Joe Brown with the NFL guy.
YouTube.
What?
James Brown. James Brown, sorry.
And will forever be linked to Lillehammer.
It's so serious.
And the incident.
How has that impacted thing never happened.
Your life and skating, you think?
Nancy wearing like the power suit.
Yeah.
Well, I think for skating...
Very 90s outfit.
Yeah. This is late 90s now. Folks, look this up. I don't want to play all of it.
Yeah.
It's very awkward. There's a lot of awkward silence and stuff, and it's just very bizarre.
You think they'd cut it up a little bit so it'd be less
weird. It's really weird.
I saw the producers like, no, let it breathe. It's so awkward.
I think that's what it
is. We want it to be so cringe.
You hear all the room noise, too?
That's
on purpose.
Like, let it be as cringe as possible, right?
Because that adds to the awkwardness.
Mm-hmm.
You know, truth be told, it's easy to boil this whole thing down to Nancy Kerrigan versus Tonya Harding, good versus evil, heel versus face, right? But truthfully, like, you know...
It does seem like it has some extra dimension to it, that it's like, there's got to be some weird background story, like...
Right.
That, like,
it isn't like Tonya Harding attacked her.
Right, exactly.
There's layers here that are just twisted, and I do feel bad for Tonya Harding, because I don't think she had an easy life.
No.
Before all this. You know what I mean?
Do you remember the first time he hit you?
One that sticks out in my head. We were at the 7-Eleven, and I got nachos. And he said that they would make me fat. And he hit them out of my hand. And then he grabs me and says, let's go. And we go, bam.
I don't know why. Like, I've always suspected that she knew, but she didn't really, like, participate, if that makes sense. Like, that's
she just was aware.
Yeah, like, that's...
Like, CC'd on the email.
Right, exactly.
But like, never replied to it.
And didn't even maybe endorse it at all.
It's like, possible.
Like, I don't know. I just get that gist from it. Like
I get the gist.
It almost feels like almost like a tragic accident or so, like, you know what I mean? Because she didn't like do enough
to prevent it.
Right, exactly.
I think we can both agree the biggest heel in this whole thing is Jeff Galooly.
Absolutely. That guy's a scumbag.
Jeff Stone, whatever.
I don't like him.
I don't think anyone does.
This is all his fault. if anyone gets most of the blame, it's Jeff
Galooly. That's
right. Unless Tonya Harding is revealed like on her deathbed that it's like this, it was me all along. Yeah, like, yeah. I just set Jeff up. He's an idiot. Like,
he's
like
a dumbass.
Like everyone, like she just like goes full evil.
One way or another, it is a strange story of two, again, top level competitors. And that aspect, their skill levels and what they did was overshadowed by this bizarre controversy. Again, it was short-lived in terms of America's public conscience. It was really odd. It did resonate for quite a while. Whenever the names are brought up, they're always going to be tied together.
I would say it's short-lived, but it's very memorable.
Exactly.
Like, that's the thing.
And I'd say, above all, Quinn, it truly is an acid-wash memory.
Absolutely.
Folks, thank you so much for breaking the ice here with us. Next week, we will be back for something completely different. Don't worry, there's no follow-up to this one here, okay?
I mean, what can you say?
What can you say? Folks, let us know your thoughts on Jeff Galooly.
Yeah.
Did Tonya know? Did you see I, Tonya? All of those things, folks. Let us know on Twitter at AWM Podcast. Join our Facebook group and leave us a review if you don't mind. But hey, Quinn, something different next week, right?
Yeah, all
right,
totally different.
So we'll be skating on by next week. Until that time, folks, thank you so much for being here. I'm Joe Marotta. That's Michael Quinn. We'll see you next week for more Acid Wash Memories.
See ya.
Like what you heard? Be sure to leave a review and subscribe on your favorite podcast app. We will see you next week.